I have a Bible study tonight. You'll see Miss Linda, my brother DeMarcus Johnson. See y'all over here. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hope everybody's having a good day. Amen. We getting ready for Bible study on tonight. It is 7 o'clock and we got some fresh content for you all. So we want you all, let me know in the comment, where you watching from? We got some Chattanoogans. Is anybody watching from West Tennessee or Alabama, Florida, Texas? Where you watching from? We're getting ready to have a good time. Come on, clap. As you clap, invite somebody in. You know somebody who's looking to build wealth, ready to start a business, get into the marketplace, and thrive. Look, we're decreeing and declaring, all right, that for the rest of the year, as we go into 2022, all right, y'all get ready to make some money. Multiple streams of income are getting ready to head in your direction. So take this time, invite somebody in. You do not want to miss this content on tonight. Y'all ready or what? Ready or what? We gotta bring you in, right? Hey, hey. Y'all know I'm happy because I'm teaching on business and finance tonight. Because I really want y'all to get this BMW, you know what I'm saying? Somebody let me know where you're watching from. Come on. Rock. Hey, we're getting ready to learn some. You need to be smiling right now because you're getting ready to be blessed tonight. You're getting ready to be empowered. You're getting ready to be transformed through business, the marketplace, and of course, wealth. We're getting ready to get started, y'all. But I need y'all to invite your friends in. I need you to invite your family member in. I need you to invite every young adult in. Because we're getting ready to change the trajectory of your life, all right? One more minute, invite somebody in. Lee, clap. Hey, got some new music for you? It won't be boring tonight. You gonna get some out of this. Hey, y'all think I'm crazy. I'm a little cray-cray for real, though. Hey, I see y'all. I see you moving side to side. Some of y'all clapping. Hey, hey. Slow music tonight. We just go pray. Dear Lord, we tell you, thank you, God, on today. We thank you for being so good to us. We thank you, God, for being so faithful to us. We thank you for this time of empowerment, this time of sharing. We pray, Lord, that someone's life is changed forever. That after this teaching, Lord, the juices will begin to flow. Lord, we thank you, Lord, right now that something on the inside is going to be ignited and sparked so that we can start businesses, so that we can start hiring our family members and build wealth in our communities to leave a legacy for our family. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Look, my name is Coach Ricky tonight. I'm not Pastor. Oh, guess my name on the screen, Pastor. But I'm Coach Ricky tonight because I'm going to be your business coach tonight.
So invite everybody in right now. I've got a lot of requests on this, this subject on business marketplace and what I need to do to build wealth. And I pray that you all get something out of this. So I'm a Bible preacher. Yes, I'm a pastor, but I'm going to be coach tonight. But I got to lay a foundation so that we have something to go back on in reverence. So I'm going to start in Luke, the fifth chapter. The word of the Lord declares, so it was as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep. Entrepreneur, business owner, that's your word today. Tonight, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. Or the King James Version says, let your nets down for a drop. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats. So they began to sink. All right. So tonight we are starting part one on business, marketplace, and wealth. All right. The first affirmation that I want to release over your life right now. First point, you are created, you are anointed, and you were appointed to solve a problem in the earth. All right. Let me say that one more time. All right. I'm going to start off with the first one. You were created to solve a problem in the earth. Now, I don't want this to go in one ear and out the other because y'all have heard that probably before. If you read any type of finance books, any books on entrepreneurship, if you've listened to a finance guru or real estate guru, they all talk about, you know, identifying a problem in the earth, identifying me, all right? But I want to release it. I want to announce it. I want to decree and declare once again that you were created to solve a problem in the earth, that in order for you to build wealth, in order for you to create multiple streams of income, you have to be able to solve a problem in the earth. So I need you to pause right now. Think of your life, whatever has God called you to do, whatever God has anointed you to do, whatever he has appointed you to do, get that thing in your spirit, in your mind right now. And whatever that is, God has created you to do that thing. He's created you to work your assignment. So you were created. You were anointed, meaning that God breathed on you. He's using you right now to execute every God-given assignment that he has mapped out for your life. So you may not think that you are adequate or qualified enough, baby. Look, somebody needs what you have. All right, whatever God has placed you to do in the earth to solve a problem, all right, you are important in the kingdom of God. All right, so let's look at Abraham. All right, how God began to use Abraham. Abraham, he was used to teach us faith. When we look at Moses, his job, his responsibilities were to lead the people out of the wilderness. And our Lord and personal Savior, Jesus Christ, when we look at Luke, the fourth chapter, verse 18, all right, Jesus himself said that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Pause right there. All right, when we talk about the Spirit of the Lord, here it is in the second phrase, because he has anointed me. That's what you have to decree and declare over your life every day, that I am anointed for this. I am anointed for business. I am anointed in the marketplace, and I am anointed for wealth. So you got to learn how to be in, even right now, begin to shift your whole mentality that, baby, you are anointed to make money. That money has no other choice but to come in your direction. Money is coming from the north, south, east, and west. Money is coming from strangers. Money is coming from friends. Money is coming from Fortune 500 companies. Money is coming from the government. Why? Because God has anointed me for business. I'm trying not to preach early this tonight. So Jesus said that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. All right, because he has anointed me, because he has empowered me, because he has enabled me, because he is using me to do what? To preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recover sight to the blind, to set at liberty to those who are oppressed. So when we look at Jesus, watch this. The point was that you were created to solve a problem in the earth. So Jesus, there was a problem in the earth, that there were poor people who needed the gospel. There were people who were brokenhearted, people who had trauma, people who were hurting, people who were experiencing weakness, people who were captive by, they were bound by depression, bound with infirmities, bound by this, bound by that. And there are also people who were blind and oppressed. So Jesus said, you know what? I see a problem in the earth. And God has anointed me to be the answer and the solution to the problem. So whatever God has called you to do, and whatever you desire, whatever a business that you want to start, look, you got to be like Jesus. Identify the problem and be the solution to the problem. And know that God has anointed you. He has specifically mandated you to go out into the world to help those people who need your products and your services. Look at somebody. You need to lift your hands right now and say, I'm anointed for this. To my new entrepreneurs, to my current business owners, I need you to lift your hand and say, I'm anointed for this. I'm anointed to sell cakes. I'm anointed to do business in the community. I'm anointed to get that building. God has anointed me for this. So in order to build wealth, content, get your notes and pencils out. You must be able to meet a need or solve a problem. I need that to marinate, all right? Because a lot of people are starting businesses, are trying to get into entrepreneurship, and you're not meeting one of the two qualifications when it comes to business owner, being a business owner and getting into the realm of entrepreneurship. You have to be able to meet a need, all right? You have to be able to solve a problem. All right, let's take my life. Let's look at Ricky Taylor Basketball. I started Ricky Taylor Basketball in 2013. I've been in business for 8 years. I've had some ups and downs. I've, you know, had some of these kind of situations. But when God gave me Ricky Taylor Basketball, I saw a need. I come from West Tennessee, and I did not receive adequate basketball training. And I still got a full ride basketball scholarship to the University of Tennessee at Chattanooga. I owe UTC nothing but love, owe no debt, no nothing. All right, so when I graduated, I said, hey, if I would have received adequate training in Brownsville, Tennessee, I probably would have went to a high Division I university and probably made it to the NBA. So my thing is, I knew that there were a whole lot of people in my same category have aspirations on playing at the highest collegiate level, going to the NBA, going overseas, but there's no one to show them the way. So after I graduated from West Tennessee, there was a different culture when I got to East Tennessee. The culture of basketball was different. A lot of people did not like basketball. There weren't too many trainers. So I said, okay, I still need that. People need basketball training to get into school for free, to increase their confidence so that they can feel good about themselves. And guess what? God gave me a business because there was a need. There was also a problem. There weren't too many trainers. So I started RTB, all right? And now, because God has given us favor, we have expanded to 8 different AAU teams. We have over 200-300 teams a year, a summer, coming to Chattanooga, Tennessee to play in our tournaments because there was a need. People needed exposure. People need to get out there to play in front of college coaches. People need to have write-ups and videos and all that good stuff. So there was a need. Now, that's my first business. All right, one of my other business, Possible Trucking. All right, a lot of people think I'm in trucking because of the revenue. That is one point. But when you think deeply of the trucking industry, all right, one need that America needs is to eat. People need food. People need clothing. People need medicine. People need products. Every product you see in Walmart has been on a truck. All right? So the reason why, all right, Possible Trucking, Spirit Logistics is thriving, because guess what? We're able to meet a need. We're able to feed people. We're able to clothe people. People need all of these things in order to live. All right, so here it is. So entrepreneurs are in business to meet a need or solve a problem, and most entrepreneurs do one or two things. Here it is. If you can provide a needed service and a needed product where people and the consumer cannot live without, then you are in business. All right, so think of the business that's inside of you. You have to ask yourself the question, do people need my product? Do people need my service? And if it is no, You have to have an honest assessment about your business that I need to get into something else. Because let me, I'm Coach Ricky tonight. I'm gonna coach you. Because a lot of people, they are passionate about a lot of things that are or that aren't in demand. Let me say that one more time. There are, I know you're passionate about this. I know you're passionate about that. But if there is no demand, if there is no need for it, then you're gonna be frustrated and you're gonna be wondering why your business ain't growing. You're gonna be wondering, why nobody don't wanna come to me? Because maybe there is not a demand. So you have to be able to do analytical research. Once again, to my mentees who know me, all right, those y'all my mentees, I'm coaching you. You have to read and research. My two big R's. Before you get involved, before you start a business, before you launch out into the deep, you need to read and research. I didn't write that down. You need to write that down. You have to do your analytical research. How many people are purchasing this? How many people need this? How many people will subscribe to my service? You have to do your analytical research. For example, for my trucking company, I started my trucking company in March 2018. I just didn't go out here and just start a trucking company just to be cute. Hey, y'all, I got a trucking company. No. The devil is a liar. I have to read. I have to go out to drivers. I have to watch on YouTube. I have to Google a whole lot of information. I have to purchase books on how to start a trucking company. Guess how long it took me? 6 months to complete. So it doesn't happen overnight. All right, but what's inside of you, you have to read and research and ensure that there is a demand for it, okay? Moving right along, okay? Why should you start a business? Some of y'all wonder, why should I start a business? Well, why is it important? Now, my personal belief, I believe everyone should start a business. There are so many tax incentives. There are so many creative things that you can do. And once again, I'm all about being honest and real, transparent tonight. I'm going to give y'all a few of my games, a few of my principles that I use. So, for example, why do I believe you should start a business? All right, it comes to the tax incentives. Me and my business, so this is how I do it. If I don't feel like paying taxes, I don't have to pay taxes. How's that, Pastor? I mean, how's that, Coach? Because I own my business, all right? You get to dictate your own salary. Hello? Are y'all listening out there? Somebody give us some. Somebody put some in the comments. Say, okay, I hear you. I teach a teacher, some coach me tonight, Coach Ricky. All right? You get to dictate your own salary. I'm going to tell you what I did. When I don't feel like paying taxes, I'll pay myself $20,000, $30,000 for the year. Hey, pay minimal to no little taxes. I own a trucking company. We have a lot of depreciation, a lot of tax holes, loopholes in the tax system that a lot of people aren't aware of. I do a whole lot of creative stuff because I have my accountant. I have that background. So whenever I'm getting ready to get a house, all right, now I'm going to increase my salary because I'm the boss. I'm the CEO. For an example, if I made $100,000 and I know I need to qualify for this house, I guess I'm going to say I made $80,000 this year, $90,000 next year. So that's why you should start a business, because you have ultimate control. You dictate how much you make. And it's that simple, okay? Let's move on. Let me carve out. Let me teach this. So Jesus was an entrepreneur. For those who do not know, Jesus was a carpenter. He worked with his hands. I believe that there was a demand for his services, that people needed things to have to be carved out, to be designed. Jesus was a carpenter. They needed things to be fixed, whatever that was. All right, Mark 6:3 says, is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? So Jesus was an entrepreneur. So the one whom we worship, the one who we love, our Savior, our Redeemer, the one who's anointed to heal the blind, the one who's anointed to heal the sick and cast out demons, Jesus himself was in business. He was an entrepreneur. Not only was Jesus an entrepreneur, but guess what? Some of the disciples were entrepreneurs. Peter, Andrew, James, and John, they were all fishermen. All right? Matthew, he was an accountant. He was the tax collector. We look at Peter owned boats. When we look at Paul was a tent maker, according to Acts 18:1-4. So the people who paved the way, Jesus' disciples, when we look at Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, they were all in business. And if they were in business, then why aren't you? in business, all right? So the disciples were entrepreneurs, all right? We had fishermen, we had accountants, and we had people who owned boats, and we had tent makers. Next thing that you have to understand tonight, people of God, is that there are 30.7 million small businesses. All right, let me give you the number one more time. There are 30.7 million small businesses. All right, and here it is. Small businesses comprise 99.9% of all United States business. What does that mean? All right, in order to be considered as a small business, you must have under 500 employees, okay? And many of us, we are the only employee. We are the only contractor within our particular company, within our particular business. So what you have to understand, people of God, is that you cannot be ashamed about starting off small. A lot of people, my business, blah, blah, it's just me. No. You need to embrace that because, all right, if it's just you by yourself, you are part of that 99.9%. All right, the economy, the world, the government, all right, our economy, it relies on small business. So you are an integral part of the whole United States, of the whole world economy, because of your small business. But what I love about small business, people gotta watch this, small businesses generate millions of dollars too. So just because you got a small business does not mean that you cannot have a multi-million dollar company. Hello? All right? Let me say that again. Just because you are a small business does not mean that you cannot generate millions of dollars in revenue. All right, there are a plethora of businesses, small businesses, that are multimillionaires. All right, so now I told you that because I want you to start dreaming and thinking big. All right, that what's inside of you, somebody made millions off of it. Somebody is fruitful off of it. Somebody is thriving off the idea that God has in place inside of you. So whatever that vision is tonight, we're going to water that vision. We're going to water that seed. We're going to water your business, and we're going to cultivate that thing tonight. And I pray that everything that God has put inside of you, that it has no other choice but to come to pass. I come to speak faith. I come to preach faith that whatever inside of you, you will execute it, and it shall come to pass. Here it is, encouragement. Zechariah 4:10 says, do not despise these small beginnings. I see you, new entrepreneur. I know you got a lot of ideas. I've been there. Trust me, I know. I know you've been trying to do some things with your ministry, trying to do some things with your business, trying to do some things what God has planted inside of you. But for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. I come to activate. I come to activate that work ethic tonight. You got to understand that when you start working on that small thing, when you start working on that thing that God has put placed inside of you, God rejoices. The Lord rejoices. The Lord is pleased. He is satisfied to see the work begin. So my question to all my visionaries watching me, to all y'all, you know, future millionaires, to all my dreamers, to all my people who've been having stuff in your spirit, when you're going to start working? And as soon as you start working, the Lord will be rejoicing. So here it is. I'm about to teach y'all now. So as you begin to start your business, as you begin to launch out into the marketplace, as you begin to build wealth, all right, you have to be able to build a strong infrastructure and legitimize your business. There you go. All right. You have to build a strong infrastructure and legitimize your business. All right. Now, so let me start off. Then I'm going to teach. All right. You got to get an EIN number. You got to get a logo. You got to get a website, letterhead, business cards, and envelopes. All right. Now, my concern tonight is that I know a lot of you. I watch what you post. I watch what you work. I see you. All right? We can no longer have illegitimate businesses. Let me say that one more time because I'm getting ready. We can no longer, as a people, as African Americans, Caucasians, whoever watches this, come to watch it, whatever race you are, we can no longer have illegitimate businesses where we have bootleg businesses. There are a lot of people. I got selling t-shirts, selling food, and they ain't got no EIN number. What's an EIN number is an employer identification number. You have to register with the Internal Revenue Service in order to be legit, okay? This is called birthing your baby. You have no legitimate business unless you have an EIN number. So when next time I see you, the next time we converse in conversation, I need you to have your EIN number. The IRS needs to know who you are. Now, I'm scared of the IRS. I don't want the government. The government is your best friend. I'm going to give y'all some different kind of tea. Y'all never heard this teaching before. The government is your best friend. Did you not know that the IRS, the government, wants you to do business and wants you to profit in your business? All right, look, I've had the opportunity to apply for multi-million dollar contracts with the government. And guess what they said in the writing, the underwriting? If you are not a for-profit business, you do not qualify. Ouch. Because all we want to do is, I just want my little nonprofit. Look, you are entitled to make money. I'm going to encourage y'all tonight, whether you say amen or not. You are entitled to make money. I know some of y'all, you don't want to ask for a lot of money for your services. You feel like you always want to charge people the low. No. You got to make your bread, all right? Especially if you want to do entrepreneurship full time and you want to pay your bills, you got children to feed, you got rent, mortgages to pay. You can't be undercutting your prices to appease people who don't have a budget. So guess what? For people who don't have your budget, you got to go somewhere else to people who can honor your budget. You are entitled to make money. Lift your hands and say, I am entitled to make money. For you can no longer demonize yourself and put yourself down, all right, for trying to make money. The government wants you to. Why? Because they want a little something in return too. All right, so got to get an EIN number. Logo, all right, you got to have your branding together. We're going to talk about all that. Got to have a website. Once again, if you go get a business, you got to do it the right way. It's called legitimizing your business. All right, and the reason why I'm telling you all of these components, EIN, logo, website, letterhead, business cards, and envelopes, is because you're going to need this stuff one day. All right, you think it's not important. No, nobody ain't gonna visit my website. Look, I believe there are over 40 to 60% of people who visit your website before they make a purchase. I do it all the time. Before I buy something, I look at the website because your website is a reflection of who you are. Your website is a reflection on how you feel about your product and service. All right, a lot of people do that before church. Over 40 to 60% of people are looking at church websites before they visit the church. A lot of people look at your business website, your business webpage, before they purchase your product or service. You have to make this investment. There is no skipping this step. Before we talk about building wealth and creating multiple streams of income, or before people paying on your web, you got to get a website. No more bootleg. Once again, here it is. Tonight, we are talking about legitimizing your business. I want you to be legit. If I have a friend who come to me and say, man, who sells t-shirts? Hey, bro, go to this website right here. Look at all. They have somewhere to go. I'll have somewhere to direct them. Hello. Business cards, envelopes. Because here it is. Without proper infrastructure, you'll have a deficit in one or more areas. All right? Case study. Look at Luke, the fifth chapter. And we're still in Bible study. Jesus, then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. So I want you to think of the boat as the business. All right, Jesus in the boat, Peter's in the boat, and the boat did not sink. Why? Because the boat had a strong infrastructure. The boat did not have any holes in it. The boat did not have any pieces that were torn. All the wood, all of the material was on the boat, and the boat was in condition. The same thing applies for you. If that boat had a hole at the bottom of it, the boat would have had water filled in it. That's the same thing, the same perspective, the same illustration you have to live with your business. Does your business have a strong infrastructure? All right? You have to be able to get to a point where your business has a strong infrastructure. Can your business stay afloat? order for your business to stay afloat, you have to have these components: an EIN number, a logo, website, letterhead, business cards, and envelopes. Without those core components, you will have a hole in your books. That at some point in your business, you're going to need their website. You're going to need to write a letter of recommendation for a high school student who looks up to you. You're going to need business cards to exchange information. You're going to need an envelope to mail certified letters. You're going to need these things. And without these core components, your business is subject to fail. That's why it is that important. So Jesus, Peter, them, they had a good boat. They had a good infrastructure. They just weren't going out there. But they had the assurance that this boat couldn't make it from point A to point B. So you don't want to play with fire as you start your business, as you launch your business. You want to ensure that you have everything solidified. Amen. All right? So here it is. What does it take to start a business? All right? Say that again. What it takes to start a business. A desire. Okay? Look, I'm reading a book now called Think and Grow Rich. And one of the first subjects that they were talking about is desire. All right? And desire is, do you really want it? Okay? Do you really want this? Now, my thing is, I can't hang around people who don't have desire. I just can't do it. It frustrates me. All right? I just can't do it. So the number one thing that you got to have is desire. You got to want to do this thing. All right? Because for so long, some of y'all have been talking about getting ready to write a book, start a book. You're still on the first page. Your desire, you don't really want to do it. All right? So in order to build wealth, in order to build these multiple streams of income and to emerge in the marketplace, you have to have desire. All right? That's why you got to stop hanging around, all right, business friends, businessmen, and businesswomen who don't have desire, still in the same place, still stuck, still stranded, still stagnant. All right, you got to have desire. You got to be driven. All right, and what I love about D, you got to have faith. Now, let me stop right here. All right, because when we talk about faith, we preach faith, we teach faith, we say, I'm getting ready to do this, I'm finna, we got that spirit, I'm fixing to, I'm finna do this, and there's still no point of execution. All right. And because you lack faith. I have a different level of respect for people who start a business. Because when you start and launch a business, is an indication that you got faith. That you believe that when you step out there, something has to happen. All right? And faith, here it is, it indicates and it involves a risk. That's what the definition of entrepreneurship is. An entrepreneur is one who takes on risk. That's called faith. An entrepreneur is one who takes on faith. So you have to be able to have faith that what I'm getting ready to step into, what I'm getting ready to start, what I'm getting ready to launch, it will work, okay? So you got to have faith, and it comes with risk. You have to be able to identify all the risks that are involved with starting a business, all right? Next one, E, work ethic. Look, I just turned 32 the other day, y'all, something. I'm getting old school. I ain't got no filter no more. But I'm just so tired of lazy folks. I'm so tired of slowful, procrastinating. I'm tired of it. Look, these young folks don't want to work today. I believe there are a lot of people, over 5 million people in the United States that quit working their job because they don't want to work. They're lazy, content where they are, don't want to do nothing. But in order to build wealth, you got to put in the work. I got scripture to back you up. Luke 5:5, but Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. King James Version, I believe, or NASB, Master, we have worked all night. Let me say that one more time. We have worked all night. And here it is, I got this Tony Evans Bible. Master Simon replied, we've worked hard all night long and caught nothing. So they were out there putting in the work, and guess what? They caught nothing. Here it is, which leads us to F. Staying optimistic when nothing is happening. Do y'all know how many days I went when I didn't have nobody to train? Do you all not know I almost filed bankruptcy in my trucking company? Oh, y'all, I know y'all look at me now. Oh, ooh, Rick doing it. But you don't know the whole story. You don't know all the times where I had to struggle when I didn't know how it was going to pay the trucks off. I didn't know how I was going to make ends meet. I didn't know. All right. And I had my little bankruptcy thing. I was getting ready to file with the whoever government, whoever it is. So I was like, Lord, y'all burnt that thing up because God made a way. All right. And yes, I had my little season of struggle. But guess what? The whole time I was staying optimistic. Lord, some way, somehow you're going to work this out. So to all my business owners, if you're not generating sales, if you're not getting leads, if you feel like, man, there's no growth, there's no productivity in your products, in your services that you're offering, you must be willing to stay optimistic. You have to stay positive that if I continue to work the vision, if I continue to work the plan, then eventually I will end up getting the results, which I prayed for. Point, here it is, all right? Case point. Started RTB in 2013. Y'all, some of y'all know my testimony. Started my first camp in Dalton, Georgia, because that's where I was coaching. I got 1,000 brochures printed off. Printed them off, passed them out to Chattanooga, Dalton. I was all over the place, going from school to school. Hey, I'm expecting about 300 kids. They had a count. Guess how many kids showed up? 16. I done pulled out all the bleachers. I'm thinking that thing gonna be packed. But guess what, y'all? I had to pull those bleachers back in because I look stupid. All right, that's what faith is. Faith make you do some stupid, crazy stuff. Fast forward, 2016, kept working the vision, kept editing, kept modifying, kept planning, kept meeting with people, kept doing it, kept finally, we figured it out. All right, first tournament, 18. Then that next one, we had our biggest tournament of the year, 36 teams. Next tournament, 36 teams. Next, 36. I was like, okay, we can figure it out. And then that next year, 2017, every tournament was filled to capacity. All because we stayed optimistic and we kept working. All right, so people got entrepreneurship, starting a business. It's not for the faint at heart. You have to keep working. You have to keep planning. You have to keep writing until the vision comes to pass and we fill that whole gym up to capacity in the name of Jesus. Okay? So that's what it takes. You got to have desire. Now we're getting to point number 5, shifting your mindset to build wealth. How do I shift my mindset? A, you have to specialize in a trade. Now, I'm reading a book called Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill. I highly recommend it. It's the number one book I want you to purchase. This book has blown my mind literally because this book is written by doctors, written by lawyers, by entrepreneurs, by Fortune 500 company CEOs, and they begin talking about specializing in a trade. That, letter B, the academic education that we receive from K through 12 is insufficient. It's not enough. Meaning that we have to go outside of the educational system to become wealthy. I know, I need y'all to get this. This is very critical because a lot of y'all still trying to figure out why you can't get wealth. What am I missing? What's the difference between me and the CEO of Walmart, the founder of Kroger? These people went to get outside education. They went outside to get financial literacy, to be coached by businessmen, to be coached by entrepreneurs, to be coached by financial gurus. So what is the problem is in our society is that we limit our education on the school system. And once again, you can go read the book for yourself. These CEOs, these people with $200-300 million a year in revenue, they said themselves in the book that academic education is not enough. That you have to go outside and to get additional education. You have to go outside and learn how to start a business, on how to take out loans, on how to do all this stuff to generate revenue for your company, all right? So you have to be able to specialize in something. Chattanooga State is one of the best schools in here in America. Every trade school, every two-year program where you can get to become a painter, a plumber, to get your CDL license, to specialize cosmetology, y'all welding. There are a plethora of skill sets out there that are readily available for you, but you got to go out there and get them because they prepare you for the real world. They prepare you to become a wealth. They prepare you to start your own business. You have to specialize in something and master it. So you have to become master in that field. People call people who are masters in their field. All right? I own an Airbnb. I needed a contractor. Guess who I called? Mr. Cecil Bob, who's been doing this stuff over 230 years because he specialized in a trade. So once again, you got to start putting your mind right now. What can you specialize in? What can you master? What can you become good in so people can come in and call for your services? All right. Why? Because academic education is not enough. All right. Here we go. Now, talking about shifting your mindset. All right. What is the difference between starting and launching your business? All right. So people start, but they never execute because they never did launch. I got this principle from Pastor Keon Henderson in Houston, Texas. He said, I don't teach people to start a business. I teach people to launch a business. Because if you're going to go on out there, you might as well go on out there. Hence, Jesus told Simon Peter, launch out into the deep. That I need you to put your all in it. And that's the issue, that a lot of people are starting, but you're not putting your all in it. You know, you halfway doing it. You halfway, you're putting in half effort. But when you begin to launch a thing, you're putting your all in it. That as soon as I get off work, I'm going to eat, feed the kids, do what I need to do, go work out, and I'm working on my business. I'm working on how can I grow this thing because I am called to launch my business. What has God called you to launch? All right, you have to put your all in. You cannot be naive. You cannot be intimidated. You can't be fearful to launch out there. If you're going to know, go on and do it, you need to go on and do it and quit playing with it. Because once again, all right, I know a lot of people who went on to glory, all the mothers, fathers, deacons of the church, talking about they get ready to do this, and they never executed. We never did see the manifestation because they started something and they never did launch it. So I need y'all to launch in this season, all right? Because your wealth and what you need is in the marketplace, okay? Wealth is in the marketplace, all right? I just got done doing some studying, research, reading and research on the medical business, the healthcare business. All right, will I get into it? I don't know. It's probably not for me. But the medical business, one of, I think it's over 20, 30% of the world's economy. All right, Medicare, all that stuff. So you got Medicare, the healthcare industry, you got transportation, which is about 2025 will be a $1.5 trillion industry. Right, what you need is in the marketplace. All right, so whatever you're working on, if you're a barber, cosmetologist, all right, that's you're in the marketplace. There's somebody needs your services, okay? Now, I'm very adamant about you starting a business because your vision is connected to a business. I put a post on Facebook because I really want y'all to get this, that whatever vision you have will more than likely require you to start a business. All right, if you start a janitorial service, you have to get an EIN number. All right, even if you start a nonprofit, you ain't even trying to make no money. Guess what? That's still considered a business. St. Jude in Memphis, Tennessee, all right, nonprofit organization. But guess what? People still send donations to them. People still have to be paid, all right? And whatever vision you have, all right, whether it is to counsel people, to coach people, to provide your certain product, to provide food, to provide whatever type of service that's inside of you, you gotta start a business. All right, so whatever that vision is, you have to start a business, whether you believe it or not, if you want to be legit, okay? Now, so you have to really get into this mindset, all right? Shifting your mindset. So once again, all right, the point is shifting your mindset to build wealth. Have you ever read a book and it starts off so boring, like you just can't get into it? And y'all, for all the last 10 years, past 10 years, I was wondering, why all these books on wealth start off so boring? I'm writing a book now. All right, why does it start so? Because they're trying to shift your mind. All right, your mind has to elevate. Your mind has to shift. All right, and so here it is. So as we began to talk about building wealth just doesn't come overnight. It's a process. It takes some people 7 years, some people 10 years, some people 20, 30 years to build wealth. So you have to make a decision that in order to accelerate and expedite my way to become wealthy, are you going to either work for 30 years on a job or start a business? Because one of the quickest ways To generate wealth is to have your own business. You dictate how many sales you make. You dictate how many clients that you have. All right, so here it is. I'm telling you this because I want to talk to the business owners and entrepreneurs who have to start off from scratch. That you are not like Donald Trump, where his parents started him off, gave him an inheritance of $1 million to build whatever he wanted to. I didn't grow up with a silver spoon in my mouth. I didn't grow up with my daddy, hey son, here go $100,000 to go buy you a duplex. No. I had to start from the bottom. I had to start from scratch. So I had to make a decision. Am I gonna work this job for 30 years and wait on 401k and wait on retirement and wait on my Social Security until I get 65 and retire? No, the devil is a liar. Go read the book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad. The poor dad tells the son, I need you to get a job, save your money, work 30 years and retire. That's what the book, that's the summary of the book. That's what the poor dad says. The rich dad says, start a limited liability corporation. Start a business and hire employees and you'll reach your goal much faster. So you got to make a decision. All right. Do I listen to the rich dad to start a business? All right. And hire employees. All right. Or do I listen to the poor dad's advice, which is okay. If you want to wait that long, I ain't got nothing to do with that. If you want to work your whole life on a job, that's you and your business, that's you and your life. But I told the Lord a long time ago, I ain't waiting till I'm 60 to buy me a house. I'm not waiting to become a millionaire at 40, 50, 60. No, the devil is a liar. I'm going to get this while I'm young. After all the preaching I do, after all the serving, and all the giving that I do, I'm not waiting till I'm 60 years old to build wealth and get what I wanted. So I've decided to take on the mentality of the rich dad. Go buy the book. It'll bless you. Rich Dad, Poor Dad. All right? That, here it is. In order to build wealth, watch this, three areas. And I think I hit it on the head, the hammer on the nails. You either have to have a high-paying job, you have to sell a product or offer service, one of the three. If you want to build wealth, you gotta be good at one of them. You got to have a high-paying job, meaning that you got your doctor, your lawyer, whatever, making six figures on your job, all right, where you save up whatever for 5-7 years, and now you can go ahead and use your own money to splurge. All right, most people don't have their testimony. I forgot to do the research, but probably the average salary in America is probably $42,000 for one person, all right, between $30,000 and $50,000. All right, now you got bills, you got mortgage, you got rent, you got children to feed. That's going down the hole. So in order to offset that, you got to start a business so that you have money to play with so that you can go out here and build wealth and get what you want. All right. So here it is. I'm almost done. I got 12 minutes to finish this. All right. You got to have strategic planning. You just can't go out here and start a business just to start a business. All right. Here's the quote for the night. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. All right. Let me say it again. If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. You have to be able to plan out. How are you going to market? Who is your target audience? How much am I going to charge? Because a lot of people just out there, just start some, don't have no plan, cannot see the business all the way through, don't have any goal setting, don't have any forecast, don't have any projections because they did not have strategic planning. And according to Think and Grow Rich, Napoleon Hill, they said in the book, all right, that most millionaires, most billionaires are the best at strategic planning. That they get a group of people, they come together 2 or 3 times a week, and they plan, they see it all the way through. So that means you got to be detailed. You got to be organized. You got to be able to set goals with realistic expectations. Now, if you only got 20 t-shirts to sell, you can't go out here and say, man, I'm getting ready to make $1 million with 20 t-shirts. All right, so you gotta have realistic expectations. All right, set goals such as, I wanna sell 20 shirts a month. Now we're getting ready to go somewhere. Now, all right, we have a pinpoint. We have a goal to reach that I gotta set realistic expectations. So after you have the strategic planning, now you gotta start building internally. You gotta be able to create systems. All right, that means your internal system. You have to run a business that's an efficient business, that runs smoothly, that it doesn't take you 3 hours to do this, but you can do it in 10 minutes. You got to be you got to have productivity. It has to be productive. If someone go come to work for you, they don't want to work 16, 24 hours, but can they get the job done in 1 or 2 hours? All right, so when it comes to creating systems, you got to invest in software. Y'all, I thank God for software. For people in IT, I got friends in IT. I thank God for software. All right, if there is a software for your product or service, please, pretty please invest in the software. All right, I know we try to cut corners. I know we try to save. I know we got budgets, but you have to invest in software. So if you have a restaurant, all right, all this taking cash and all, that's okay. But at least have your iPad out. Okay, this costs $15, this costs $5. All right, so it can keep track of your sales and revenue, all right, because you're gonna need those when you come tax her. The reason why you must be a credit system is because you want to prevent burnout. There are a lot of people who experience burnout because of too many hours, because there aren't any systems. So that's why when it comes to my trucking company, I purchased the best software. I don't mind paying $1,000 to $2,000 a year for my software so that we won't experience burnout. All right. If I did not purchase the software, it would take us probably 5 to 8 hours a day. But now that we've invested in the software, I can be done with my work between 8 and 10 o'clock, maybe 11 o'clock every day, because we invested in the necessary software so that we run our system efficiently. All right, I'm almost done. All right, I want you to build your team, become the business. All right, just can't pick anybody, can't pick any Joe Blows. You can't pick your family members because they family. Now, don't get me wrong, all right, some family members are gonna be there, but the characteristics of your team, you need people with character, you need people with your cadence, competence, and capacity. Character, people ain't gonna misrepresent your business. They ain't gonna go out here and misrepresent it and cause a bad image, a bad representation of your business because they got good character. Y'all come to my AU tournaments. Y'all know we got the baddest board in the city of Chattanooga because we got people with character. We got people with cadence. We got people who can keep up with the tempo. We got people who can keep up with the flow. We're talking about building your team as you begin to hire employees, as you begin to send people out to different cities, setting up your little table at venues. You gotta have people who understand your cadence. Then we're here to make some money. You gotta have people who have competence, who really understand, who really get sales, who really understand what customer service is. Then you just can't talk to anybody any kind of way and expect them to come back. Why? Because it will hurt your brand, it will hurt your business. All right, building your team number 4, capacity. You gotta have people who wants to grow with you. You gotta have people to see the bigger picture. That is not all about one person. There is no I in team. That's why you have to surround yourselves around people. All right, build a team that has room to grow, that has the capacity to want to go to the next level, okay? Last but not least, I want to talk about the power of partnerships and marketing. I'm almost done. All right? I have grown my business because of strategic partnerships. That means that I had to identify all my weaknesses. I have to identify all my partner strengths for my trucking company. All right. One of my weaknesses was I could not retain drivers. That was my weakness. All right. We didn't have a lot of trailers and stuff like that to pull. So guess what? I have to partner with people who've been doing it for over 10 years. All right. So if you want to build wealth, if you want your business to grow, sometimes you may have to partner with people. For an example, I partnered with a company that did over $100 million in revenue last year. All right, I had to learn from them. I had to grow from them. So guess what? I had to give up 24% of my company in revenue to give to them so that they can run my company to this best. So I basically outsourced my whole business to them for a share of my company. I gave up 24% of my company. Once again, there are a lot of things that y'all don't have. Some of y'all don't have a building. All right, but guess what? You can partner with somebody who has a building. Hey, I will give you 10% of my proceeds of my revenue so that I can establish my business right here in your place of business. Look, you got to learn how to negotiate, y'all. All right, everything you need is part of partnership, but you have to be willing to negotiate. If there's something you don't have, you have to be able to give up something in order to get what you need, all right? And the greatest partner that you can have is Jesus, all right? Guess what, all right? When it comes to strategic planning and partnering, look at Simon Peter. Jesus tells him, hey, launch out into the deep cast your nets, your net on the other side, on the right side. Guess what? Jesus gave him that advice. Jesus gave him that wisdom. Jesus gave him that because Jesus was wisdom. So don't ever start your business without consulting the Lord. I have to go spiritual for you on at the end. All right? All right? Because your greatest partner you have is Jesus. There are a lot of things that I have today because I prayed about it. I said, God, what would you have me to do? How should I price this? How should I market this? How should I do this? And because I consulted my other partner, spiritual business partner, Jesus, the Holy Spirit gave me insight, direction, and wisdom on what to do. And here's a quote. If you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. Let me say it again. If you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. So if you want to hit $1 million, you got to go together. You got to partner with people. You got to be able to team up. Look, I love my Caucasian people. They don't mind working together. Look, they just merged their companies a few months ago last year. I just admire them because there's no I in team, because they want to go far together. All right? Last but not least, and I'm done. All right? Marketing. You have to put yourself out there. All right? You can no longer be intimidated. You cannot be fearful of your business. All right? Once again, nobody ain't going to market your business like you. Your friends, your family, your boo, your spouse, you got to be the one. You got to be the go-getter. Look, there have been a plethora of times I posted for RTB. I only got 4 or 5 likes. I don't care. But guess what? Everybody know that I train. All right? Everybody know that I run AU tournaments. All right? When somebody friend, hey, I need somebody to train my kid, who can I go to? Oh, Ricky Taylor. Why? Because I was marketing. Social media, all right? The best form of marketing is word of mouth, all right? People need to know that you are excited and passionate about what you do. You can no longer, all right, be hiding. Well, I'm posting too much. Look, I took a class. Thank God for CBS for sponsoring me to attend a class from Rhode Island University up there. They said you should at least post five to 10 times a day. Now, if I'm thinking 2 times is too much, I'm not posting enough. Hello. It's this thing called funnel marketing, all right, where they have conversion rates, where you receive a 2 to 5% conversion rate when people click on your link. And if you're not hitting 1 million people, you ain't going to make no money. If you ain't hitting 1,000 people, you ain't making no money. So you have to put yourself out there. You have to be a display of your business. That I'm going to post more. I'm going to share more. I'm going to do more stories more, because you're your business. You're an entrepreneur, all right? So you can't be intimidated. All right, you got to have paid advertising. Go on Facebook. Pay for an advertisement on Facebook and marketing because you want to be able to reach your target audience. I do it all the time. I pay $50, sometimes $100 to market our tournaments, market our services. Why? Because we need revenue. We have a target audience for fall leads, for personal training, for AU tournaments, all right? Verse 7, I'm done, all right? The Bible says, so they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. So that was a form of marketing. They signaled, hey, come over here. See what we've caught. See what we got. So here it is. I'll leave you with this on building wealth and creating these multiple streams of income. I'm going to teach you how to scale your business, all right? If you want to grow your business exponentially, if you want to expand it, if you want to stretch it, if you really want to generate millions of dollars in revenue, A, you have to think franchise. You have to think like a franchise. Think about it, y'all. Just really think about it. I really want y'all to think about it. We pass by McDonald's every day. We pass by Burger King, Baskin Robbins, go to Walmart, all these shopping centers, Food Lion, Nike, all the stores in the mall, and most of them are all franchises. So my question for you tonight, why can't you do the same thing? All right, for too long, we have limited our thinking, all right, to thinking that we're just local. But for some of y'all got a global ministry. To my people who sell clothes and jewelry and all that stuff, you just don't need to be focused on people in Chattanooga, people in Brownsville, people in Atlanta. But go to Dallas, Texas. All right, think franchise. How can I multiply what I currently have? Look at the text. It's what, look, I believe Jesus them, all right, started the franchise industry. All right, look, they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come help them. Here it is, and they came and filled both the boats. At first, they started with one boat. Jesus told them, launch out into the deep, start with one boat. And when they began to master, all right, that boat, when they filled that boat, they got a second one. They ain't did nothing but start a franchise. So that's the eyes that I, when I read scripture, I look at it in a business lens. Like, dang, they had two boats. They had another location. They opened up another location. They started their franchising right there on the boat on the river of Lake Genesaret. And they began to sink. So think franchise, be rinse and repeat. So after you master that thing, after there's no more for you to do, you need to repeat what you just did. All right? Last but not least, automate your business. All right. I'm in the business group on Facebook for Chattanooga. And the owner of the account asked a very question. He said, can your business still function without you being there? I'm going to say it one more time. Can your business still function, still thrive, still work without you being there? That's why I recommend the basketball board of directors. We about to meet. In order for us to grow, to go to different cities, I can't be there. Because if the business is predicated on one individual person, guess what? Your business is going to go so far. There go your card at the ball. If you must physically be there, your business will only go so far. That's the honest God truth. So that's your question. I really want your juices to be flowing tonight. Dang, can my business really work without me being there? Kiki, Miss Christina, Mr. Marlon, all right, to my people watching on Facebook, if you must physically be there, your business won't go so far. All right? I love you, people of God. I appreciate you all for being tuning in tonight. All right? I love y'all. That's it for tonight. Business, marketplace, and wealth. I hope y'all got something out of it. I'm going to just ask some of y'all on the screen if you got any questions. DeMarcus, you'll feel free to ask me any questions tonight. I'm here. Anybody got any questions before we leave?
Nah, I appreciate you, man. It was a good show, man. It was good.
Appreciate you, DeMarcus.
You're welcome, sure, man.
Your auntie, Miss Linda, is proud of you.
I'm going to tell you, I said thank you,
too. It's the start of the night. We just wanted to get your mindset. Everybody right. Good out there? God bless y'all so much. Good seeing you all. Forward this video to somebody who needs it. But once again, this All Empowerment 2022. I'm working on some content. All right, so I wanted to teach y'all this because we're getting ready to create some content and some material because we want to get y'all some funding for your business. All right, but you have to have those core components, a website, logo, and all that stuff. And I'm going to try to get y'all $50,000 to $150,000 in funding for your business. All right? Some people may be able to get $1 million to $4 million for commercial real estate property. All right? But you have to be able to shift your mindset. You have to build a strong infrastructure in order to qualify for the funding that we're going to try to get you in 2022. All right? Got a whole lot of work to go. Got a whole lot of stuff to do. So pray for me as we get the content together. All right? Because we want to help you all win. All right? Anybody else good? Everybody else good? All right.
Hey, Pastor Rick.
Hey, Mr. Marlon.
Man, I want to say thank you for all the information, man. It was very much needed. Hopefully, I can use some of it.
Awesome. Yes, sir. Hope y'all got something out of it. Well, we get ready to go out. Before we go, I'm about to pray. Dear Lord, we tell you thank you tonight for being so good to us, for meeting us on business, marketplace, and wealth. Lord, we pray, Lord, that the people of God retain this information. We pray for their businesses, Lord, that everything that's inside of them, that book, that business, that vision, Lord, that they will have the work ethic to execute it so that it can come to pass. We pray, God, for multiple streams of revenue, praying for income, we're praying for clientele, we're praying for favor, Lord, that you begin now to enlarge our territory. So, God, we pray the prayer of Jabez. Lord, that you enlarge our territory and give us increase. We pray, Lord, that you cover us and keep us all week long, cover our families, cover the church, cover our souls, cover our spirits. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen.
And amen. Amen.
Love you. God bless you.
Appreciate it.
What? Hey, I'm gone, y'all.